we've shown that DNA is actually the software of life, and you saw some excellent examples of it in the previous talk. And the thing I learned, I know who not to push too far. Chemically, we wrote the genome starting with four bottles of chemicals, literally going from the ones and zeros in the computer to writing the four-letter alphabet, and shown, in fact, that it's totally interchangeable between the digital world and the biological world. We then wrote the entire 1.1 million letters of the genetic code, booted it up, and got a new cell driven totally by the software. So that's what we call synthetic life. We actually use living cells to boot it up, but you change the software and you change the species.
And you, as Martine mentioned earlier, you're also working on doing this with pigs. Yes. In order to create organs for humans.
We're trying to create a humanized pig. I won't talk about the political implications.
A humanized pig.
It's been done with monoclonal antibodies, which were developed in mice. Basically, the genome was changed so they would produce the human version, not the mouse version, and those can be used in human therapy. With rejection systems, our immune system recognizes all kinds of surface antigens. In the case of the pig, a lot of molecules that are very close to our own, but we're just rewriting the genome to change all of those to the human version so that when they're put in the human body, our immune system will see them as human organs, not as pig organs.
When you did this work with the human genome under Clinton, that was 15 plus years ago now, you mentioned to me it took 9 months to do one and $100 million.
That's right.
And now you're trying to do 100,000 of these in 1 year.
Yes.
Science has come very far.
The thing that's changed, and it just changed in the last 12 months, I've been waiting a long time for this, is the threshold of DNA sequencing technology and computing technology has just passed this threshold that I was waiting for, where we can now do, probably for less than $1,000, very large numbers of genomes. To try and sort out some of the traits that Dr. Fallon was talking about, these are rare events, probably fortunately in the population, on the order of maybe 1 in 50,000 or so. And so we need literally millions of genomes in the database to be able to find in each of us these patterns and understand what they mean. So it's a law of large numbers. My genome's been on the internet for 15 years now, and there's not much more today that I can interpret from it than we could 15 years ago. That's because there's really not much to compare it to. So if we start to build up hundreds of thousands and millions of genomes with all the phenotypic information that goes along with it, just like the nice PT scans, we're going to do quantitative MRI imaging on everybody that we can. And there's nice software now developed by our colleagues at UCSD that take these images and convert them into digital volumes. So we can get, for example, the hippocampus volume. And you can then understand what's in your genes associated with that hippocampal volume and your memory. But we can measure changes in as little as 3 months. In fact, we can measure changes in your brain 10 years before any symptoms show up for dementia. So it gives sort of an early warning system. It gives ability to understand the genes associated with this and hopefully new avenues to do something with it. So it's a massive data problem like has never been dealt with before when you think about all the things associated with your life, including how your brain works, all your chemical composites, your complete digital medical record. We're measuring all the chemicals in the bloodstream. We're measuring the microbiome, which is about, you have 100 trillion human cells, you have 200 trillion bacteria. It's not a personal thing, everybody does. And to understand these interactions is an important part of understanding us as human. And obviously this gets into the behavioral dimensions, as we just heard very nicely. But if we are software-driven machines, like every other biological species on this planet, understanding how to interpret that software, including the parts of the software associated with interacting with the environment and feedback control mechanisms, we will start to understand our species quantitatively for the first time. Everybody's asked questions, what's nature and what's nurture? We will be able to solve in the next decade mostly of what's nature. By difference, everything else is nurture.
And what do you see as the human application of that knowledge?
The ideal application that we see is preventative medicine. If you know that you have these risks for different diseases, in the cases where you can do something about it early, you can change behavior, change what you eat, maybe have different therapies. But we're also hoping to find the genes associated with healthy life. For example, the scientific community has looked for genes and changes associated with diseases and traits that they're studying. Nobody's really looked for the other side of why don't you get that disease? Why is he not a murderer? I have a risk allele for Alzheimer's disease. And a lot of people are heterozygous for the APOE4 allele. In theory, if you go to 23andMe or any place else, it says you have a 30% increased risk of getting Alzheimer's disease. But not everybody, obviously, with that allele will get it. And there's no history of Alzheimer's in my family, in part because the males on my father's side died in their 50s and 60s, so never got a chance to see if they had Alzheimer's. But I had a quantitative MRI with radioactive dyes to see if there was any amyloid, which you can actually detect 20 years before you would have symptoms. And my brain is totally void of amyloid. So I have a clean bill of health, at least for the next 20 years. So investors, it's okay. So why not? You know, if I have these genes associated with increased risk, and I have multiple wounds, not just APOE4, there must be a protective alleles that also prevent that from happening. The same is true for breast cancer and almost any other trait that you can find. Any of you done 23andMe, there's very few, if any, things on there that say, all right, you are in the 100% category. Mm-hmm. It's in this 1 in 1,000 to maybe 1 in 3 risk. It's never 100%. So understanding our complexity is part of this massive computer analysis we're going to do. If you can turn on the protective alleles, then even if you're at risk, you can change things. We saw examples of how changing the environment can maybe turn on and turn off different genes. If we understand that at a key level, we can change humanity in lots of ways, but primarily shifting medicine to a preventative medicine paradigm.
One of the concerns is that the understanding, the acknowledgement of the underlying propensity to be some way goes deeper and farther, faster than the understanding of how to actually prevent that thing, such that we know, for example, that you have a propensity to have Alzheimer's at some day in the future, whereas we don't have a cure and we don't know exactly what will prevent that. How do you tell the consumer or the average human this is valuable information even if we haven't gotten to that next phase?
Well, medicine has totally proceeded on that basis. You can measure something before there's ever a treatment or a cure for it. And usually having a quantitative measure and understanding the underlying molecular components will lead to these kind of treatments much faster. But there's sort of, it's very clear, there's like two categories of humans. There's ones that want to know this information and ones that don't. And it's amazing, it's in every group. If you ask medical student classes, half the class don't want to know. It's scary they're going into medicine and they're advising everybody else on this information, but I don't understand how you don't want to know. Not, as the video said, I learned in Vietnam, knowledge is power. knowledge is power for your own life. It's knowledge for your, it's power for your family. Preventing disease and knowing something in advance you can do something about, I think, is the most empowering thing anybody could possibly know. But we obviously don't want to force it on people, but we want to show with clear examples by having this data how much more you know about your life, how much more your physicians will know, how it can totally change the directions and outcomes. Our goal is to help people have healthy, long lives, not necessarily live to 150. But if you do have a healthy life, you're probably likely to have a much longer one as well.
You brought up Vietnam. You grew up California surfer.
Yes.
Self-described slacker. And then you went to Vietnam. How much did that shape the work and the efforts that you're making today?
Tremendously. I moved from the Bay Area to Southern California to take up a surfing career, and got drafted off my surfboard, which was a tremendous cultural change. but, you know, I learned, being in the middle of a war, that if you had knowledge, you could change the outcome of people's lives. You know, if you didn't have that knowledge, you had to watch them die. So it was a very powerful lesson that basically has driven me for the rest of my life.
It set you on your path.
Yeah.
You knew that it was about finding as much about the future as was humanly possible to protect as many people as humanly possible.
Well, and to change the outcomes from knowledge. You know, even looking back to what medicine was like in the 1960s, it was frighteningly primitive. It's still pretty primitive. I mean, we know roughly 1% of the knowledge that's contained in our genome. I mean, look at the examples that Martine just gave of, you know, this story keeps happening over and over again of finding new treatments, new avenues that go beyond conventional wisdom. That's why I love some of the earlier stories. And my career has largely been based on ignoring wisdom and what's possible. The current NIH director turned down with prejudice a grant in 1994 to sequence the first genome in history, as it turned out, with this new method that depended on mathematics and computers. You know, in almost every case in history, conventional wisdom is wrong. And we have a chance, if we have a new starting point with a new data set, to totally change the future. I mean, this is, we're at this threshold in humanity. I don't think we'll have totally merged human machines, but I would love it if I had a USB port on the back of my head and I could,
you would want that.
I would absolutely want that, you know.
What would you want it to do?
Well, if you didn't have to go look up things on Google, if you could just, you know.
You'd want it to put Google out of business.
I'm going to Paris today. Can I get the French app so I can speak French? I mean, who knows? You know? It would really be nice if surgeons had this information. Mm-hmm. If your doctor actually knew something besides what you tell them they found on the internet. You know, people are educating their physicians. They're not educating themselves. We need some ways to have this digital DNA constant interconversion to upgrade our software and to understand it, to understand what we heard with these behavioral traits that affect very much of society, affect people's lives. But it's also an important lesson in terms of people get very caught up in the eugenics of this. If we know what causes manic depression, we want to eliminate it. But Kay Jamison wrote these books on how most successful people have some degree of manic depression. So we could wipe out the success of humanity by trying to correct so-called errors in the genome. So we don't have the knowledge to rewrite the human genome. We're not trying to make smarter pigs, we're just trying to make them as good organ donors. We need to be very careful about trying to rewrite our own genome, but we do have the ability to understand that information and to act on it, and maybe use the same tools that we're using to rewrite the pig genome to rewrite the genome of a stem cell that could then reactivate. I like to coin new terms and new uses of things. If you're making something more youthful, is that euthanizing them? It's not the normal usage of the word, but we wanted to make it the company slogan, but I got talked out of it. Our goal is to euthanize people, but we can, just like what happens with stem cells, you can reprogram your DNA to be in a more youthful state. It's been one of the consequences of the early bone marrow transplants. Bob Hariri, co-founder of Human Longevity, has actually found that looking back at these patients after the ones that survived the stem cell transplants actually had a much more youthful state because their DNA got sort of reprogrammed to this earlier version. So there is hope for trying to eliminate disease as we know it, or at least postponing it, and to improve the human condition through the ultimate use of this knowledge that we've all been working for.
So what does the future look like 100 years from now?
I used to get asked this question, so 300 years from now, you're looking back, and I said, well, I hope I'm still there to answer the question, but that is really not the goal. I think if we can turn medicine into an information-driven science, we will basically, in the process, turn humanity into an information-driven species where we're working from knowledge, not from millennia of myth and the strange things that happen in our societies.
J. Craig Venter, thank you.
Thank you.